Hey everyone, it's almost our last session before we head to the summer season. Yikes. Before we go into this lesson, we're actually going to have to think back 120 years before Solomon became king. Now, remember the time that Samuel was judge and judges governed Israel. Now, you might remember that the people didn't want another judge after Samuel. They wanted a human king. And even though God was already their king, he gave them what they asked for, a king. He also knew that any man who was crowned king would still have a sinful heart. And we've seen examples of that over the past several months. God warned the people that the kings must always obey him. Now, fast forward to King Saul and King David. You see, both kings, they sinned. They both were punished. These decisions that these kings made affected not only themselves personally, but also their families and the people that they ruled. And so, what about Solomon? We're about to have a look at Scripture and see how he did as the wisest king. Now, to do this, we'll need to read from the book of Deuteronomy so we can see what God said to the people about their leaders and the commands that they should follow. This is Deuteronomy 17, verses 16 and 17 in the New International Reader's Version for today. The king must not get large numbers of horses for himself. He must not make the people return to Egypt to get more horses. The Lord has told you, you must not go back there again. The king must not have many wives. If he does, they will lead him astray. He must not store up large amounts of silver and gold. All right, so it seems as there are some certain things that God clearly said he did not want any kings or leaders to acquire or collect for themselves. He told them, don't get many horses, many wives, or large amounts of silver and gold. Why is God telling the rulers this? There's a reason. Well, horses were mostly used for battle. The more horses that a king had, the stronger his army would be. God is telling the Israelite leaders that they shouldn't rely on a big, powerful army to defend and protect them. Also, God didn't want his people to go back to Egypt to trade for horses. They had left Egypt after being set free in Exodus. Now, in verse 17, God also explained why he commanded not to take many wives, because it could turn the leader's heart away. It would turn his heart away from God. You see, God knew that kings often married other women from other countries in order to keep peace with those countries. Of course, God's design for marriage had always been one man, one woman for life. And so taking many wives, that's disobedience to God's plan. And especially during the days of the Bible, the wives from other countries would bring their false gods with them, which would make it very easy for the king to worship the idols, these false gods, along with their wives too. You see, God wanted the kings of Israel to worship him and him alone. Now, the last piece of instruction you'll notice was that the king wasn't supposed to collect lots of riches. So don't try to hoard up gold or silver for yourself, God's telling them. God knew that kings could get so carried away with getting rich that their wealth would become an idol. This is actually true of anyone, not just kings. God wanted them and us to love God more than any sort of treasure or riches or wealth. So these instructions, they were given to be learned and obeyed by God's people. God wanted his people to depend on him for their success instead of relying on their own ideas, their wealth, or big armies with lots of horses. All right, so let's keep going with Solomon's example again. What happened with the rest of his rule as king? The Bible tells us that Solomon collected huge amounts of silver and gold. Yikes. He also traded with the Egyptians for many horses and chariots. Yikes again, those are two instructions that he broke already. It's important to note that yes, God did bless Solomon with a lot of these riches at first, but Solomon kept going and attaining treasures and those horses, which obviously were disobeying what God commanded him to do. Now, here's 1 Kings 11, verse 1 to 4. Now, King Solomon loved many foreign women, along with the daughter of Pharaoh, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonianite, and Hittite women from the nations concerning which the Lord had said to the people of Israel, you shall not enter into marriage with them, neither shall they with you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon clung to these in love. He had 700 wives who were princesses and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. For when Solomon was old, his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not wholly true to the Lord his God, as was the heart of David his father. Yikes. Ugh. There's another instruction that Solomon ignored, and like majorly. 700 wives. God gave the warning, and it came true. Solomon's heart was turned away from God. He was not true to the Lord. Obviously, this is not good. We know that God is holy and that he demands complete obedience. And because he has to punish sin, God spoke these words to Solomon, found in 1 Kings 11, verses 11 to 13. Therefore, the Lord said to Solomon, since this has been your practice, and you have not kept my commandment and my statutes that I have commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom from you and will give it to your servant. Yet for the sake of David, your father, I will not do it in your days, but I will tear it out of the hand of your son. However, I will not tear away all the kingdom, but I will give one tribe to your son for the sake of David, my servant, and for the sake of Jerusalem that I have chosen. Wow. So even in the middle of punishing Solomon, God showed mercy by saying that judgment would come later. Notice that he wouldn't tear the kingdom away during Solomon's days for the sake of David, his father. And even then, one tribe will remain to Solomon's son to rule over for him. There's an important principle about obedience and disobedience here. Notice that Solomon's sin didn't just affect him. It affected his son, the future king. It affected all the people in the kingdom. David learned this earlier too. And if we remember, Solomon was definitely affected by David's sin with all the fighting with the brothers that we heard before. Now Solomon's son also would have to face the consequences for his father's sin. However, you might have noticed the flip side of this. Because of David's obedience, because of his faithfulness, God showed mercy to Solomon. And Solomon's son would have a remaining tribe as a reminder of this too. So what can we learn about this? We must remember that our sin can hurt ourselves and others, but our obedience to God can actually bring blessing to us and to others as well. What started out as Solomon's personal sin became a sin throughout his nation, and which is why God gave so many commands for the kings of Israel to obey. He knew the people would follow their leaders, kind of like a domino effect. So, King Solomon reigned over Israel for 40 years before he died, and then Solomon's son Rehoboam took over the throne. Now, when Rehoboam became king, the people hoped things would be different. Solomon had actually been pretty hard on the people, forcing them to work for him. And so the people sent one of Solomon's servants named Jeroboam to the new king to see if he would be kinder and treat them better than his father Solomon had. Now, what do you think the answer would be? Would this new king Rehoboam be a good and kind king? Or would he be a harsh ruler? Let's see what the Bible says. 1 Kings 12, verse 13 to 15. The king answered the people harshly, rejecting the advice given to him by the elders. He followed the advice of the young men and said, "My father made your yoke heavy. I will make it even heavier. My father scourged you with whips. I will scourge you with scorpions." So the king did not listen to the people, for this turn of events was from the Lord to fulfill the word the Lord had spoken to Jeroboam, son of Nebat, through Ahijah the Shilonite. So clearly Rehoboam was not going to be kind towards his people. Discipline by scorpion. Yikes. But notice, who brought all of these things to have happened? The first 15 shows us that the turn of events, all of this was from the Lord to fulfill the word of God. As always, God was in charge of everything that had happened. God was and is in control. Remember, he told Solomon that one day his kingdom would be torn from his hands and given to his servant to rule. So Rehoboam refused to do what the people asked, and the people They got very upset. And it wasn't before long that they made Jeroboam, Solomon's servant, the new king over Israel. Out of the 12 tribes of Israel, only one, Judah, kept Rehoboam as their king. Again, exactly as God said would happen to Solomon. For the sake of David, God would at least let Solomon's son have one tribe, the tribe of Judah. King Rehoboam ended up in the city of Jerusalem
as the capital of Judah, where he gathered men to fight against Jeroboam and the rest of the tribes, hoping to get the kingdom back. Rehoboam was ready to fight with 180,000 warriors. 1 Kings 12, verse 24 shows us that God spoke about this, actually. And this is what the Lord says.
Do not go up to fight against your brothers, the Israelites. Go home, every one of you, for this is my doing. So they obeyed the word of the Lord and went home again, as the Lord had ordered. Wow, God was certainly showing his sovereign control over this whole situation. The kingdom was torn from Solomon's son, just like God said it would. And now with Jeroboam ruling over the 10 tribes, Rehoboam ruling over the one tribe of Judah, and for those keeping count, Benjamin and Levi, they were actually spread out among the land with some serving each king. With that happening, Israel was now split into two kingdoms, 10 in the north and Judah in the south. At this point, the kingdom would be separated, divided as the after effects of Solomon's sin. This would lead them to further conflicts for them with lots of hurt and pain. Our hope is that through this, you can actually see why God demands our obedience. It truly is better for us. We are to love him with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And although we don't carve idols, statues, or have, 700 wives or husbands, or we don't gather horses and armies personally, at least I hope we don't, there are other ways that people find themselves turning away from God. What kind of video games do you play? What kind of videos do we watch? What do we do when no one is looking, or we think no one's looking? How do we treat the people around us? See, our prayer is that we would live in such a way that others would see that we love God above everything else, and that we want to obey him and honor him with everything in our lives. Remember, whether we obey or disobey, that can affect others for good or bad. This is worth thinking and praying about. And so in your prayer time, if God shows us an area in our lives where there is sin, let's take time to ask for forgiveness, to turn from it, and to be obedient. As we put on some worship music, pray together and ask God to expose these areas where we have been turning away from him. And let's take that time to turn back to him, knowing that he is our loving Heavenly Father.